I'm nine. During my youth, I lost my sense of being colorblind. In between white supremacy and black nihilism, and me churches, corner stores, and the prison systems, hoteps and preachers on the block, they was dropping wisdom. I would pick it up and just give it a little rhythm. They said my lineage had a couple kings, a couple queens, a couple thieves, a couple fiends. Despite the struggle, you can change the story, that is my advice. I read in color, they see black and white. You just saw the cover, but there's more to know. Don't close the book, I got more to write. You can change the story, that is my advice. I read in color, they see black and white. You just saw the cover, but there's more to life. Hello, average, let me introduce you to awesome. That Harlem Renaissance age of some excellent artists. That miseducation, that midnight marauding. That life before Eve ate that fruit in the garden. They say, you might be on the wrong side of history. Well, that depends on who's writing, who's reciting, who's typing, and who likes it. If we want peace, somebody has to do the fighting. We exit Egypt, happy to speak resistance. Then turn around and ask Pharaoh for his assistance. What is logic to the ignorant? What's forgiveness to people who think they're sinless? We are those fully exposed, Adam and Eve hiding our weakness. Folks who wanna be close, but the devil stands between us. Who knows the dirty souls with an urgent need to be cleaned up? They oppose my solution, everybody hates Jesus. Don't close the book, I got more to write. You can change the story, that is my advice. I read in color, they see black and white. You just saw the cover, but there's more to life. Don't close the book, I got more to write. You can change the story, that is my advice. I read in color, they see black and white. You just saw the cover, but yeah, there's more to life. What's protest to the law? Should I pray or should I riot? Do I want peace or do I want power so I can try it? Who's gonna give the truth when these church moms retire? When censorship gets you fired and nobody gets inspired? I don't care what you look like, black, white, or magenta. I don't care where you come from, Africa or placenta. We all desperate and broken, given the same dilemma. Do I serve God or do I make him fit my agenda? I remember thinking I was Daniel with the lions. I'm like Israel in hiding when it's time to fight Goliath. I've been broken, I've seen death working, I've fought out, I've been knocked out. I know where hurt is, I run from the truth, but I know where the church is. I failed doing my job, but yet I know my purpose. Praise Jesus, I was blind, but now I see. But my problem is I think I see too many things.
Let us chiropractic crack open the spine of this book. Turn a few pages and take a deep look. This is not the catcher in the rye. This is the African who caught the slave catcher's eye, an invisible man who has the whole world watching. Shall we meet the protagonist? For I am a colored cog in the capitalist wheel, with baby-faced bronze skin and melanin appeal snatched from the cradle of civilization. My name is Louis Portier. Arrived on these shores, but I've got more to say. From Bali to Barbados to Beaufort, South Carolina, Sierra Leone to Sapelo, with sugar cane on my fingertips and shackles on my feet. There were limitations to emancipating me until I sunk my teeth into Juneteenth. Freedom tastes like grandma's sweet potato pie. But it goes from massive plantation to mass incarceration as the Jim Crow flies. All of this happened more or less. This is Up From Slavery meets Porgy and Bess. Wilson and Kenya Barris, James Brown and James Burke, Kehinde Wiley and Kara Walker, George Carruthers, Clinton and Washington, Carver, the Great Migration and Reconstruction, from Black Wall Streets to Harlem Artilliers. This is black survival and success put on full display, whether it's the Little Rock or the Charleston Nine, trying to integrate or praying to stay alive, thinking that if my work was good, somehow y'all would recognize my personhood. But nah, instead I had to hustle this chocolate charm, this black brilliance, this ebony ingenuity. I mean, I know what this nation has done, can do, and is doing to me. Also, what it could be, and therefore, still, I rise from
1619 and beyond, here I stand, from being three-fifths of a compromised plan, using the breath in my black lungs, shouting words from a place of black love. I am a man.
I guess we'll go ahead and get started. We still have a few folks trickling in, but we will welcome them as they come. Let me see. I'm going to stop sharing my screen for just a second so I can get all set up. Okie dokie. Right, can everyone see that? Okie dokie, all right. Well, let's go ahead and get started. Welcome to Justice Advocacy 101. I'm with my colleague, Kristen Lennox, and we'll be your host for the day. If you're tuning in, hopefully you're in the right place, Justice Advocacy 101. I'd like to introduce myself. I'm a policy analyst at Voices for Virginia's Children. I specialize in public health and social justice, and also serve as the lead coordinator for the Racial Truth and Reconciliation Virginia campaign. Amongst other identities, I identify as an advocate, an activist, a racial equity facilitator, a master trauma trainer. I often say I specialize in all that I've gone through as a Black woman with lived experience in Virginia's kinship foster care system and a survivor of PTSD. So these are the identities that I carry with me today, and I want to welcome the identities that you all carry with you yourselves today as well. So I'm going to pass the mic to my colleague, Kristen Lennox, to introduce herself.
Thanks, Chloe. Hey, everybody. My name is Kristen Lennox. I use she, her pronouns. And I am excited to join you all today for the Justice Advocacy Workshop with Chloe. I'm the Advocacy and Engagement Manager over here at Voices. Prior to joining Voices a few months ago, I was a direct practitioner. I am a licensed clinical social worker by trade. So I am also an educator. I work at VCU as an adjunct instructor for social work students. And I am also a mental health practitioner. So I, like many social workers, wear many hats. But all of them for me are rooted in justice, equity, and shifting the culture, decolonizing all of the things that have been instilled in us. And I hope that we'll get to practice some of that today. Chloe, when you're ready, I think you made me co-host. And then I wasn't sure. Oh, you got recording going. Awesome.
Yep, we're good to go. And so welcome to this presentation. We are representing Voices for Virginia's Children today, the Commonwealth's only multi-issue child advocacy organization. We operate with a mission to improve the lives of Virginia's children, particularly those at the greatest disadvantage. And in order to do so, we believe that every child should have equitable access to resources, services, opportunities. And for us, that means advocating for sound practices, policies, mobilizing community, being data informed, amongst other best practices to ignite change. We are also home to the Racial Truth and Reconciliation Virginia campaign, where our mission is to empower historically marginalized communities in acknowledgement of truth to promote healing, reconciliation, and justice for young people and children and families. And so when our systems fail us, when we recognize gaps, we want to intentionally promote just policies. And particularly, we advocate for equity, but our goal is to promote justice so that all people, all children are innately equal. And that's really the goal. Okay, let's see. Here's our agenda today. We're going to walk you through just an introduction to oppression, racism, inequity, and justice. We'll introduce you to different forms of change. Who are we trying to impact? What kind of change? And then we're going to really delve deeply into just change strategies. And some realistic, you know, situations we know that she'll come across and facing resistance as advocate and activist. So we'll go into some of that as well. And our goal today is really to give you more tools in your toolkit in order to leave you empowered to ignite change. And so I'm going to introduce you to this practice, but we're not necessarily going to go into it today, just in the interest of time. But we'll talk about different forms of cultural, historical, racial trauma. And so sometimes when I do have the time and I go into presentations, I like to introduce folks to the concept of just being mindful of the original natives of this nation, the indigenous people. And we'll talk at some of the tribulations that they faced, but just being mindful, I am on the Powhatan lands, as well as the Utenon tribal lands. And so this is a website that you can go to really learn about the history and the kind of space that we take up and the history behind that. So let's go ahead and get started. I want to introduce you just to a slight visual of an iceberg. And this is an iceberg that I often see used as a metaphor, in the trauma-informed care field to just recognize the surface that we see and what we don't see, that 80% at the bottom. So while the research does examine, while we often look into trauma-informed care and look at adverse childhood experiences and often use this iceberg for that framework, trauma is often an individual response, and without healing, without curing the root cause of systemic trauma or inequities, there is no justice. And so oftentimes I see people get really wrapped up in the equity buzzword, but equity is the distribution of resources with the acknowledgement that all people are not inherently equal. And so that is not just in itself. There is no equality without justice eliminating the barrier. There is no forgiveness, no healing, no moving on. So consider this iceberg as a metaphor as it relates to America's addiction with racism and the way in which racism permeates itself in all aspects of our society. And keep thinking of this iceberg as we break apart history chip by chip and justice brick by brick, in acknowledgement that we are in a reckoning in this nation, and this iceberg grows larger and larger and larger without reconciliation, healing, repair, and justice as it relates to America's legacy of racism. And so I encourage you all to drop in the chat or feel free to come off mute. We have a fairly intimate group today, so we can make this very an engaging conversation. And so I want to invite you all to engage. I come from a speak and respond culture, and it makes me feel a little closer to home when people are engaging in conversation. And so feel free to do that. Now we're gonna get an introduction to just the United States of America. And if you've been with presentations with me before, I always introduce people to our history because that is contributes to the complexities as it relates to championing justice and change. So while the United States of America is known as one of the most diverse democracies in the world, we recognize that much of its history entails systems of violence, exclusion, discrimination, et cetera. And in exploring the creation of America's core fundamental values, such as life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness, democracy, and looking at its history of exclusion, we have to recognize, how did we get here? And so pictured here are the founding fathers. Many of us learned about them in school. I learned about them in grade school as well as in my higher education. They took place in the Federal Constitutional Convention, 1787, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And the purpose of this convention was to determine how America would be governed as a nation. And so the following seven figures, George Washington, many of us are familiar with, John Adams, Benjamin Franklin, Alexander Hamilton, John Jay, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, they all played critical roles in how America would be developed as a nation and what its legacy would be. However, these individuals are all recognizably, if anyone wants to point out the similarities we see in this picture, there are quite no differences that I see here as far as the racial and ethnic representation in this picture. And so let's really unpack that. When we think of the role that these founding fathers played and how they are described to be honorable statesmen, There is no women in this picture. There is no people of color in this picture. There's definitely no Black people in this picture. They were enslaved at this time. When it comes to inclusion as it relates to other forms of identity, such as gender and sexuality, we can almost imagine that that was quite, that during this time, those kinds of identities wouldn't have been included. And so when we, and many of these people were slave owners, while they're described as honorable statesmen, we recognize that they were slave owners. They're often praised. And this is how racism permeates itself in our society, because the nation's fundamental values are inclusion. Yet in this picture, we see that all other races and ethnicities, even genders, were excluded from the crafting of our legacy as a nation. And then I can quite go on and say I was forced to, you know, write about the founding fathers, slave owners as honorable statesmen, even in my higher education. But we'll talk about good trouble a little later. But forms of good trouble is I wrote about the slaves. And my instructor said I didn't, you know, follow the rubric or whatever, and I risked my grade. But these are ways that we can subtly combat what is taught within our institutions and how that is passed down. So let's talk about cultural, racial, and historical trauma. American colonization produced long-term consequences for indigenous people or Native Americans. President Jackson signed the Indian Removal Act in 1830, which authorized the forced relocation of natives in Southeast to prioritize white settlement and white manifest destiny. So close to 125,000 indigenous people lived on millions of acres across Tennessee, Georgia, North Carolina, Alabama, and Illinois, Kentucky, Florida, and other states. But this land was previously cultivated by their ancestors and occupied for generations. And this long journey was known as the Trail of Tears. It describes the forced removal of natives who marched hundreds of miles to dedicated territories across the Mississippi River. And this was referred to as a civilization campaign. Many of these tribes became known as the civilized tribes as a method of forced assimilation, as well as white access to land. But the settlers wanted to claim the land natives built their livelihoods on, and this was systemically supported by key leaders, including one of our founding fathers, President George Washington, who believed the best way to solve the Indian problem was through a civilization campaign. And so we know that this led to a loss of language, a loss of a sense of belonging, a loss of land. You know, there's examples of how this is intersectional with housing inequities, et cetera. And so as we deconstruct why justice, why do we need to get to justice? We have to understand oppression. And oppression is referred to as a repeated experience. It's widespread. It doesn't necessarily need to be extreme. It could come in covert or as well as overt forms. Examples of more explicit oppression could be slavery or apartheid. We'll go into voting rights a little later. But covert oppression is often the civilized oppression, unquestioned, so normalized in our day-to-day that we don't even really know that it's happening unless we're actively looking for it. And this contributes to signs and symbols that we see in our media, different habits, different descriptions of peaceful protesters versus the rioters. And so this could very much contributes to what I refer to as the status quo. Now, overt oppression is often more explicit, and this is, you know, slavery. This is when a white man is killing, you know, a Black man, police brutality, et cetera. And so these are the more, when people say, oh, I'm not racist, you know, they're more so thinking of overt oppression, but they're not necessarily referencing how they're contributing to the day-to-day status quo and maintenance of implicit or covert oppression. And I was having trouble because I can't see y'all, but I just found my little squares that I can look at now while I'm presenting. So we ask ourselves why justice. And so I often get this question of reverse racism. So I'm like, let's just talk about it because I'm the type of person that likes to, you know, address the elephants in the room to contribute to greater understanding. And so, you know, it comes to this question. I often sit in presentations where, you know, I explain to people that minorities can't be racist. And so let's really break this down. Is reverse racism a thing? Is it a myth? Let's talk about it. And so I wanted to describe the most dramatic case of if we really were to argue that Black people, for example, could be racist. It would be the case of Nat Turner. And this is me as a painfully overlooking the slavery, the belief that slaves were happy, they were because they were in need of their masters, et cetera. And so this is me painfully overlooking that. Now, Nat Turner's rebellion, also known as the Southampton Insurrection, it was a rebellion of enslaved Virginians that took place in Southampton County, Virginia. In August of 1831, it was led by Nat Turner. So the rebels killed between 55 and 65 people, at least 51 of whom were white. And ultimately, Nat Turner destroyed the myth that slaves were happy and too content to rebel, which was the greatest fear of white people. And so it's why they had to further control them, surveillance them, et cetera, keep them oppressed. Now, after the revolt in Southampton, communities and states, legislators across the South considered the implementation of new harsher restrictions against enslaved and free Blacks. And in the months following the rebellion, what did this form of, we're talking about reverse racism, but what form did this act contribute to as it relates to the response? Well, it led to revised slave codes, which Virginia served as the leading state of. And they were passed in numerous Southern states who followed Virginia's lead. Slaves had few legal rights already, such as in courts, they were not allowed to provide testimony. It was inadmissible. They could not make a contract. They could not own property, even attack. Even if attacked, they could not strike a white person. So there were numerous restrictions already, but these restrictions were further became more strict as a result of the Nat Turner Rebellion because white people were scared. And so, Virginia served as the leading state as the enforcement and revision of these codes, similar to how we served as the leading state in slavery. And so that is what this form of discrimination prejudice, if we want to argue not Turner engaged in, led to. And so now let's look at this other case of Emmett Till. Emmett Till was 14 years old. He had Tourette syndrome, which led to a stuttering disorder. And so a white woman felt that he was whistling at her when really he probably wasn't. He was probably trying to be friendly because that's what he was raised to do towards white people, is be friendly and use your manners. Now, he had plans to visit his uncle Moses in 1955, and his murderers later on were found. He was lynched, and his murderers later on found that he was his murderers were found not guilty. But his death sparked the civil rights movement, and we know that this is the largest movement we learn today about in history. And even later on in life, the statements were retracted. And there were published confessions that the two men who committed the murder really did the murder. And even the white women who accused Emmett Till of whistling her later on in life before her death retracted her statement. 65 years later, when we asked, was justice, when it comes to this case of discrimination, was it served? It wasn't served until 65 years later in 2020. Where finally a piece of legislation was introduced designating lynching as a hate crime. So oppression equals power equals privilege. Power and privilege equate to oppression. So in the case of this case study and the responses that we see of Nat Turner versus Emmett Till, well, Nat Turner's case led to a bunch of surveillance, a bunch of social control, increased laws, and Black codes that targeted Black minorities due to white fear. But yet in the case of Emmett Till, here we are 65 later receiving quote unquote justice, but you could still argue that lynching happens in alternative forms such as police brutality. And so when we talk about racism, it comes with the power to systemically, we'll talk about that later, but it comes with the power to systemically control the power over people. And in these two cases, reverse racism really isn't a thing when it comes to the case of Emmett Till. He never sought any justice, but for the case of Nat Turner, that led to several slave codes, not even here in Virginia where it occurred, but across the country. And so I'm going to play this brief clip, but not the entire thing. from Dear White People.
The role of counterculture is to wake up the mainstream.
I have friend of you. Counterculture? Is that what you think this is? Your little show?
What about my show?
The show is racist.
Black people can't be racist. Prejudice, yes, but not racist. Racism describes a system of advantage based on race. Black people can't be racist since we don't stand to benefit from such a system.
Your antics are making press, Sam. This keeps men like President Fletcher up at night.
Or milk?
He's building a firewall.
Okay, it's not my fault that your son couldn't beat me in an election.
Now they're getting into other stuff, but again, you know, Sam, she's talking about, she's running this show called Dear White People, and they're concerned about the show because it's making the media, it's making white people angry. And that again contributes to white people are angry. Now we need to control this minority in her show. But like she mentioned, you know, Black people can't be racist, minorities can't be racist because it doesn't equate to power. And in this very circumstance, you can see that with her show and them arguing that she's racist, again, white people are holding the power because she's got to face this president of the university and explain her show. So again, power is very much surveillancing that situation. And Tim Wise and the myth of reverse racism explains that when a group of people such as racialized individuals have little or no power over you institutionally, they don't get to define your terms of existence. They can't limit your opportunities, and you needn't worry about the use of a slur to describe you and yours, since in all likelihood, the slur is as far as it's going to go. What are you going to do next? Deny you a bank loan? Is that what they're going to do? Yeah, right. White perceptions are what end up counting in a white dominant society. If whites say indigenous people are savages, be they of noble or vicious type, then by God, they'll be seen as savages. And I mean literally by God, y'all, because when we look at God, he's socialized as white in society. When we look at Santa Claus, he socializes as white in society. So this is the kind of, and people really believe God is white. Jesus is white. And Santa is white. And it contributes to these very moral characters and throughout history. But anywho, I won't finish up the quote because you all can see where I'm getting at here and read it yourselves. But it really roots in the end of the quote. Well, you know, if indigenous people say whites are mayonnaise eating Amway salespeople, who in the H is going to care? If anything, whites will simply turn it into a marketing opportunity. And so when you have the power, you can afford to be self-deprecating after all. And so that is the point of racism, you know, and why it's white people are superior and therefore they have hold the power. And so there are ways that people dismantling racism identifies that the oppressor group has the power to define reality for themselves. The groups take in and internalize the negative messages about them can be a response, thinking and acting like them. And members of both the oppressor and the target groups are socialized to play their roles within society as normal and correct. And so this is why I say, you know, we are not homogenous when it comes to minority communities, because there are ways that on both sides that we all play our roles and conform to in oppression. And then there's other, you know, like we mentioned area, other explicit forms of racism, such as genocide, harassment, discrimination, et cetera. But there's also individuals that are very much okay with racism and oppression. And so this is your more explicit forms, and individuals perfectly okay with maintaining these forms of oppression and benefiting off of it. Okay, so now we're gonna just take a little con break. That's typically just a really heavy part. So I wanna encourage everyone to just turn off their screens. We're gonna look at some dogs for a few seconds, and then we'll practice some deep breathing, and then we'll come back on in about 5 to 7 seconds.
Oh, no.
my dog went in to look at the dogs too. He was like, what dogs are there? So I'll just give folks a few seconds as you're coming back on, just put in the chat or confirm that you've finished rejuvenating yourselves. All righty. And so I think we have another break in there too. Thank you for your feedback, Chanel. And so we're gonna go into a bit more of, you know, a bit more empowering tactics and strategies and so how do we deconstruct all of that? And so this goes into the concept of just choosing your why. While power possesses an array of meanings for different people, it takes various forms within context, power over, power to, power from it. When we talk about justice, I really encourage people to think critically because social power highlights the relationship between empowerment and power through a set of organized principles. And we won't go into those principles today, however, but I wanna throw out two examples. Is that the women's movement in the 1960s and the rise of the Black Panther Party are rooted in the ability that, in the belief that individuals should have a fair share of power and should have a greater influence and control over important matters in their life. So to combat the unfair distribution of power, one must specifically name the power as well as the form. And thus empowerment, therefore, includes initiatives that impact individuals, organizations, communities, and society. And it requires that the process of empowerment is critical from a multi-level lens. So empowerment, it relates to the control over resources, the ability to control barriers, and a force that shapes shared consciousness. And so I wanna give you bell hooks Ashe and Honor are now ancestor, but Bell Hooks states that the definition and critical analysis of oppression has left out the complexity, voices, and lived experiences of individuals who have been severely impacted by injustice and oppression. Oppression is often described as a dehumanization and exploitation of people. And so to fight oppression, we have to fight the power through empowerment. And we got to do that in very strategic ways. And so this brings us to the concept of cultural resiliency. And I didn't name that on this last slide, but you see here, there are ways that communities are contributing to their own empowerment, such as this example here, Hair Love, in order to teach youth who are often discriminated by their hair. We could talk about the adultification of Black girls, et cetera, to love their hair and love their culture. Okay, and so now, this is a justice advocacy training, so I want to give folks my definition or Voice's definition of social justice. And so social justice is the acknowledgement that social constructs such as race, gender, norms, and class are ingrained in every component of our society. Equity in parallel of justice is an outcome and a process of addressing the system so that all members of society have the same rights, protections, opportunities, obligations, and social benefits. And so as a precious, justice is applied when those most impacted by inequity are meaningfully involved in the implementation of the institutional policies and practices that impact their lives. And now I will, I'm jumping a little too ahead. Okay, so we know there's reality, right? It's what we all experience day to day. And let's open this up for a conversation. What does reality look like when we talk about injustice? How does it show up in our society? Because we know people aren't equally equal. So, you know, in this picture, you see reality, but let's talk about some real forms when we go out in our communities, how we see reality show up as it relates to injustice. Comment in the chat, you can come off mute. Right, I'm gonna assume y'all are still practicing your deep breathing. But we'll have some other opportunities for you to chime in. And then there's equality, which is, you know, all people aren't innately equal, and therefore people don't benefit from the same supports. And so we see here, you know, you got your youth who is short like me, and you have your taller youth, and they can't see the game because, you know, they're given the same stool, but one person's taller, one person's shorter. It's not, you know, equal. So equity says everyone, we're going to distribute the resources off of need. So Chloe's really short. We're going to give her a taller stool. And this person's really tall. So, well, you don't even need a stool. That's equity. But justice says, well, you know what? All three of them can see the game. They don't have this fence in front of them. And we're eliminating the barrier. We're addressing the systemic barrier, and it's been removed. So yes, everyone can see the game. There's no need for equity. This is our new reality of equality. And so that's what we're trying to get at here. And now I'm going to pass the mic to my colleague, Kristen.
Thanks, Chloe. So Chloe's really illuminated for us the historical contexts that drive the work, that give us purpose. And doing this work, especially justice advocacy, we wanted to invite an opportunity for people to share some change strategies that they have used before, especially as we go into concepts of good troublemaking and other ways to advocate, whether it be like at a general assembly level, street level, online campaigns. But we're curious to see what people might have engaged in already before. You can put those in the chat or just come off mute. What are some strategies that you've participated in to ignite change? We will take pause and give a moment to think about that and share.
This could be your marches, this could be your, I don't know, your parent-teacher conferences, your individual advocacy. Feel free to come off mute. Asking questions, why do we do things this way? That's a great example.
Speak up and out. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lisa. Writing about change on an online publication.
Great. So those are some great examples, and we'll go into some others in the presentation. And so now we're getting into this concept of good troublemaking. Who's familiar with good troublemaking? And what's your understanding of it? I've got my picture of one of our other ancestors, Congressman John Lewis. But what is good troublemaking, and when is good trouble good? When is trouble good? Sorry, I don't mean to confuse y'all. When is trouble good?
I think trouble is good when it's for the greater good of all humanity, and not just status quo, and not just to meet the majority.
Yes. And I love that word you put in there, status quo, because that's the very concept of trouble. When we talk about trouble, it is defying the status quo, and that's why it's troubling, because it's creating resistance. Other examples, when you're motivated by looking out for others, not just your own interests. Yeah, because self-interest is actually a thing. There's two laws, interest convergence, and you can look at the law of the invisible hand, but that's just me being a nerd. Trouble is good when it's used against unjust laws. Uh-huh. Yeah, so great, driving change, that's really the key. And so we're gonna get into into this a bit, because good trouble is not a buzzword, y'all. It's an actual act. So, excuse me. Congressman John Lewis wrote, drawing on the work of Dr. King, his focus was not restricted to legislative advances. He sought economic justice, to equality, environmental justice, labor rights, political power, social acceptance, and respect for dignity of all humankind. Troubling is how we find ourselves in connection to others, how we respond, how we make and sustain. It connects to what affects one of us, affects us all, and it's that sense of solidarity. So troubling essentially explores concepts of intersectionality, responsibility, accountability across lines of oppression and injustice, and how our responses to one another lives beyond our individual human lives. And Whitney Lewis, who's a white woman scholar, inquired about the tension in Good Troublemaking, that resistance. And it's the push-pull between the visible, invisible, performative, non-performative, optical, and what forms of Good Trouble can be taken by white people. So Good Trouble provokes individuals to think more deeply about Good Trouble in action. For whom is trouble necessary? For whom is trouble good? And who can trouble? When can we choose trouble? Is voting, donating, protesting, is all of that forms of trouble? And so this really piques, you know, critical thinking around what is Good Trouble outside of the trendiness of the word. So Good Trouble is referred to as a process of finding a way to get in trouble or necessary trouble, to disrupt the status quo, to interrupt, to persist a legacy, one of which Congressman Lewis carried in his own work. And so we know an activist body takes up space, and the embodied responses may be resistance in the form of what you saw in that other picture. There's also dogs, tear gas, charges, et cetera. And oppression is felt and lived in the way in which the activist physically moves throughout the world. Therefore, the process of troubling refers to process of continuous action, whether it's standing at a protest, whether it's sitting in place, voting, providing testimony, or speaking out. And our auntie Rosa Parks eloquently noted in an interview, trouble is staying with it. Troubling is showing up, remaining present, and consistent commitment to the continuous disturbance of the status quo, not just over the summer, y'all, and the way in which we move throughout the world and living collectively. So I think I'll end with this quote with Barack Obama, because there's this concept of, you know, the both and, the good and the trouble. And so Good Trouble provokes this kind of solidarity and holding both actions in parallel. Good Trouble, it's a philosophy. It's a way and collective actions can be taken when activists advocate. And President Barack Obama noted in Congressman John Lewis's eulogy, we don't have to choose between protests and politics. It's not an either or situation. It's a both and situation. And we have to engage in protests where that is effective, but we also have to translate our passion to laws and institutions as well. And so that's really what Good Trouble theory, is an actual theory, gets at. And I'll pass the mic back to Kristen.
Thanks, Chloe. So how are solutions created? We're moving into kind of to Chloe's point in quoting Barack Obama, it is a both and. Protests and politics, it's not just either or. So moving into the area of politics, how are these solutions created in that world and in that realm? Every bill just starts out with an idea. They're founded in good reason, sometimes not. Sometimes a constituent will approach a lawmaker about a problem and legislators respond, but they only do so with limited knowledge of the issue. So they're really relying on constituents and community members to inform people with lived experience. Sometimes they are born out of tragedy, similar to like Senator Gray Deeds, and when that occurred, and the big push for mental health access and reform that happened following that. A bill is a proposal submitted by a General Assembly member to either create a new law, amend an existing law, or remove an existing law. So again, those are coming from constituents, advocates, lobbyists, sometimes, again, in response to national tragedy or problem solving. And hundreds of bills are introduced every year. Who gets to be a public official? Suppression efforts range from the seemingly unobstructive, like voter ID laws and cuts to early voting, to mass purges of voter rolls and systemic disenfranchisement. And long before election cycles even begin, legislators can redraw district lines that determine the weight of the vote. So certain communities are particularly susceptible to that suppression, and in some cases, outright targeted. So people of color, people of the global majority, students, older adults, people with disabilities. Some statistics, 70% of Georgia voters were purged in 2018 were Black. Across the country, 1 in 13 Black Americans cannot vote due to disenfranchisement laws. 1/3 of voters who have a disability report difficulty voting. I remember I was involved in some surveys after votes about just trying to figure out accessibility. Like, can wheelchairs get up the steps of the school in a accessible way to vote? Things that aren't often thought about in an ableist society. So only 40% of polling places fully accommodate people with disabilities. So it isn't also, it's not just visible disabilities, but the invisible ones too. Across the country, counties with larger minority populations have fewer polling sites and poll workers per voter. And then another example is 6 in 10 college students come from out of state. In New Hampshire, the state trying to block residents with out-of-state driver's licenses.
And so there's other forms of disenfranchisement, such as felony disenfranchisement. If you have a felony, you can't vote. I believe Virginia just eliminated that this past year. Voter ID laws, just thinking of accessibility and how difficult it is for individuals to get to, you know, your DMVs or whatever, to access to voter ID. Voter purges, we saw that a lot after this last election, just a purging of the voter rolls to find, or with these disputes that there is some sort of voting injustice going on, like we're seeing here. And then gerrymandering, there was in the last election, you could vote on an amendment that would help eliminate gerrymandering. Well, that's gone really left, but gerrymandering is referred to as racial gerrymandering or partisan gerrymandering, but it's a literal drawing of these localities so that with an effort to be able to predict the outcome of the election based on these voting districts. And so we're just going to play just a few, maybe like 30 seconds of this video, which goes into some examples of disenfranchisement as it relates to voting and justice.
We got bananas, we packed some snack bags, we got water, we're giving out pizza, ponchos if it rains.
We had people out there with like cold water coolers and like masks and people telling them to stay dry and stay alive. This is what they're doing. They're doing this on purpose so that your voice is not heard. I'm just like, this is going on right now in 2020.
Voter suppression has come up quite a bit during this election cycle.
President Trump tonight, after floating the idea of delaying the November election that he does not have the power to do, is renewing his attacks on mail-in voting. Despite no evidence, it leads to widespread voter fraud.
From the president's warnings about voter fraud via mail-in ballots to the new Tennessee law that could strip some protesters of their voting rights, or the messy primaries in states like Georgia, Wisconsin, and Louisiana.
When I think about voter suppression and people ask me, well, when did it start? And I say it started when Africans were enslaved and forced to come to this country. There has never been a period of time in this country that there was not voter suppression.
We would love for you all to, one, really share about some of the issues that are going on in your community. Why is this election important? Why is it important that South Georgia is not left out of process? Because you ain't, because Black voters matter.
Latasha Brown is a longtime political organizer and co-founder of Black Voters Matter, an organization aiming to boost Black voter turnout in presidential and local elections. Their work includes increasing voter registration, voter education, and advocating for policies that expand voting rights and access.
The first election we worked in was in the U.S. Senate race.
And NBC News is now calling Doug Jones the apparent winner.
In a special nationally followed election, Democrat Doug Jones and Republican Roy Moore fought for a Senate seat in Alabama. And for the first time in 25 years, Alabama elected a Democrat to the Senate. And the Black vote was key for the Jones win, with 96% of Black voters backing him.
We we use some new tools, new technologies to help concentrate on getting out the vote. And that's what
Black voter turnout increased drastically, and that there was an overperformance of Black voters in that particular election cycle. But we wanted to also send a message of affirmation of how Black voters saw themselves. We would convene these listening circles to talk to communities about what was it that they were concerned about, how did they see power, did they want power, and what did that look like?
Say your name. My name is Evelyn Glass. If you don't get them in the primary, you won't get them that far. Because some people just go to that one, but we got to start in the primary to get those people.
That's right. That's right.
This is primary day in Georgia. Lines in Atlanta stretching for blocks. Some standing in the rain, forced to wait hours to cast a ballot.
You've been here about 3 hours. I'm not leaving.
In Georgia, where I live, and I am a voter, on election day, what we saw is we saw long lines. I myself, it took me 3 hours to vote. We also got a phone call at 10:30 p.m. that there were 300 African-American voters waiting in line to vote.
So, I mean, just ridiculous, really. But you see some themes here. If it's the Black vote that determines an election, there's these accusations of voter fraud. Just the inequitable issues, such as access, such as who can really take off work for 3 hours, the long lines. And oftentimes this is more prevalent in Black and Brown communities that have less resources. And so this goes into the role of, I'll pass the mic back to, did I skip it? Okay, I'll pass the mic back to Kristen of who gets to be a policymaker and the role of power and how that shapes itself out in committees.
Yeah, thanks, Chloe. So what you're seeing here is a picture of the Senate Finance Committee. The money committees are the committees that really hold the purse strings and move things forward. These are where bills have to get funded, otherwise they would immediately be ineffective. Money is what's needed to move these forward. So the role of power in committees, you know, committee leaders can really serve as gatekeepers as they get to decide which bills are seen and can become laws. Oftentimes closed door conversations and exchanges can influence unjust outcomes, kind of similar, very similar to Chloe's third or fourth slide of the founding fathers. You know, look at this room and see who is taking space up around this table, who is or isn't represented here. And you can pop those observations in the chat if you see anything that comes up and resonates with you. The money committees determine the state budget details, you know, what to fund and how much. They turn ideas into laws, identifying problems and solutions, and they add details to broader federal laws. For example, how to implement FFPSA.
Families First Prevention.
Families First, mm-hmm.
So, I mean, these committees, this right here is the money committee. Well, we call them the money committees. There's a Senate Finance Committee and the House Appropriations Committee. But, you know, when you think about bills, there's thousands of bills introduced each year. Without funding, they really wouldn't have an impact. And so oftentimes these committees, like Kristen said, are the ones that really hold the purse strings. They determine what gets funded, what doesn't. But we see here there is a lack of diversity and representation at this table. And I mean, there's a lack of, we could even argue in a lack of cultural representation in politics as a whole and who gets to run on these campaign platforms, fund their campaigns, et cetera. And so, you know, no person of color, I mean, one person of color is at this table. But really, this is the most powerful committee in the General Assembly. And so this is essentially the role of power and how it plays out.
So if the goal is systematic change, there are numerous definitions of systemic change, excuse me. The consistent piece is change that pervades all parts of a system. So taking into account the interrelationships and interdependencies among those parts. Also piecemeal change, which entails changing one or several parts of a system to enact greater change.
So these are like very two different I mean, there's numerous definitions. Some people are looking for very transformative change. Some people are looking for, you know, some of that piecemeal change. We see justice is so complex, but it's this fine balance between, well, it's not time yet. It's not your time yet. Or, you know, that this form of incrementalism is what it's called, as well as more transformative change. And it's fine balance. And we know that partisan politics often plays a role. But even when you look at theorists such as critical race theorists, they often tackle liberalism in the incremental approach.
So for many, many people have spent centuries studying and analyzing social movements within social change. Some movements emerge and grow while others quickly die out. Examples of social movements include the Me Too movement and hashtag Black Lives Matter, BLM. However, the scope of change and who or what is being impacted by that change is rooted in how we are identifying and analyzing the level of change we intend to make as a practice and strategy. So sociologists analyze the following four forms of social movements, which we'll observe some more today. Redemptive, reformative, and revolutionary. Society is not changeless, therefore we must adapt to a changing society, which means acknowledging that there's different ways to approach that change. So with alternative movements, those are typically focused on self-improvement and are limited specific changes to individual beliefs and behavior. So examples of this are Alcoholics Anonymous, MAD, Mothers Against Drunk Driving, Planned Parenthood. There's also redemptive movements, sometimes called religious movements, and these are meaning seeking. So they're focused on a specific segment of the population, and their goal is to provoke inner change or spiritual growth in individuals. Reformative social movements, they seek to change something specific about the social structure, so really shifting culture and shifting mindsets too. They seek a more limited change but are targeted at the entire population. Environmental movements are examples of these, the women's suffrage movement, the more contemporary Buy Nothing Day, which protests the rampant consumerism of Black Friday. Those are examples of reformative movements and culture shifting. Then there's revolutionary movements, and those seek to completely change every aspect of society. Their goal is to change all of society in a dramatic way. Examples of this are civil rights movements, other political movements, such as a push for communism. So how much change do we need, and who does the change impact? Consider how much change you are creating and who the change has impacted to determine your scope of change. And then here, I don't know if you have...
Here you see more so, for example, you see more, depending upon which change strategy or theory you're really looking at it with, whether it's alternative or redemption, you know, there's more, very more radical changes. Let me go back to the other slide. Such as the revolutionary movement, for example, in looking at this grid, that's going to target, it says everyone, and it's more radical. So really, like, using this box as a theory, you get to determine your scope of impact, how limited that impact is as it relates to change, and then perhaps how more radical the change may be. So we can't classify all change as the same, you see, through these different change theories. And so really thinking more strategically of who is it impacting and who is the scope, and this can be used as a resource for that too.
So once that scope of change or impact is really analyzed, sociologists name the four stages of change that broader movements entail as it develops across a lifespan. So the preliminary stage is when individuals become aware of an issue and then leaders begin to emerge. This typically follows a coalescence stage when people come together and organize around a specific issue to raise increased external awareness. Institutional change occurs when the movement goes beyond grassroots and becomes more established as an organization or moves within an institution. And then the movement either conforms and adapts to maintain buy-in and success, or it declines. In analyzing these theories of change, consider one's own self within as it relates to individual change processes.
Oh, sorry, Kristen, that's from a different slide. So these we're looking at our target demographic. Sorry, I forgot to delete my notes from a different presentation.
You're fine.
So that's local, state, and federal. So in examining the kind of change that we wish to impact, right? We often have to also choose our target demographic. And so that's going to be, I'll let you walk folks through the three different target demographics.
Oh, I see now. Yeah, I'm catching up. Sorry about that. So our three demographics in this sense are local, state, or federal. So for local demographics, there's mayor, there's also city council, board of supervisors. State gets us broader. So the governor, House of Delegates, and the Senate, those might be in case, for example, we could engage with them with General Assembly. And then federal, so that's the president, House of Representatives, and the Senate. And then those would be some targets for these kinds of actions. So these are examples of different advocacy and activism strategies. We'll go over four together, those being rebel, organizer, advocate, and helper. So you can really see here on the graphics, if you can see them, they're small on my screen because I have a lot of things going on. just examples of what makes these different movements effective or ineffective, and just really analyzing these kinds of different strategies, pros and cons, and when they are effective, depending on what you're trying to target.
So we see here, there's the rebel role, and this is often more of an agitator role, often the person at the protest, often employing nonviolent strategies, targeting the power holders. It puts the problems in the policies in the spotlight. They often engage in more like exciting, what we refer to as more risky behaviors as it relates to just tackling resistance. And so oftentimes the rebels are doing the roles that really no one else wants to play, but we're thankful for them for doing this role, because it's often the person shaking things up, you know, the person at speaking out to the media, et cetera, really holding our systems accountable. There are some ways in which the strategy can be a bit more ineffective, which you see here, or promotes anti-leadership, or it can, for example, you know, there's times where an activist may be engaging in advocacy, and like a policymaker's like, can you get your people? Because we're trying to help y'all, but they're, you know, agitating and shaking things up. So there are times where this can be a bit ineffective. Now, your organizer role is more of your activist role. It's the person who truly believes in people power and the power of grassroots, often nurturing the growth of natural leaders, people who may have not previously seen themselves as leaders, but exerting their leadership in a way where they can show up in whatever leadership form. Often uses training to build skills, more collective decision-making power, and it promotes alternatives and paradigm shifts as it relates to the culture of society. I would say it can be ineffective when there's tunnel vision approach, or we see even in the civil rights movement, more patriarchal leadership, or only promotes minor reform. And then sometimes we know that activism is going to inherently get into policy, right? And so I have seen some in some ways where you have your activists on the ground advocating for a policy, but then when it gets into advocacy, when it reaches that system, that's when sometimes weren't able to be ineffective. It's not, you know, the activist's role, et cetera, that's an advocacy role, or they don't get a seat at the table because of maybe perhaps some of those rebel strategies that were previously used. So really a fine balance. Pass the mic back to you, Kristen. Sorry, you're on mute.
Yep, got it. So how much change do we need, and who does the change impact? Here we're also observing a little bit more those roles of advocate, and helper, what makes these different roles more effective or ineffective. And so I think, was this the point where we were, we wanted to, oh no, sorry, that was the next slide. In a moment, what we wanted to do was reflect a little bit more on personal stories, maybe some that you have, but also some of our own about these different roles and how they've showed up in movement work.
Yes, and then we'll analyze it for which role. So for these two roles, you have your advocate, and this is really the role that I'll say Voices plays, is the advocate role. But often, you know, the advocate is centering, so activists are like, okay, to F your political opportunity, we're gonna create the opportunity. So they're marching the streets, they're creating the opportunity, they're not conforming to the political powers that be in the politicians. They don't care if, you know, their ask is not a priority. And that's what we saw over the summer, and it did create some change. Well, in Virginia, we had a special session, there were numerous criminal justice policies that were introduced. But advocacy, for example, often centers the person in power, and it does rely on political opportunity. And so we have these are mainstream institutions that we're relying on, like your General Assembly, like the City Hall, like your Board of Supervisors, like your City Council. You're often using lobbying as a strategy, providing testimony, for example, in support of a bill or gooding with your powerful advocacy organizations like Voices to enact change. And then you're monitoring to the success and the implementation. So then you may be sitting on a work group, for example, for the Marcus Alert bill, which we have sat on. So there are some times of ineffective where we talked about incrementalism, or what's like realistic power politics. It does put the power in the power holders. It does promote, you know, more top-down strategies, more grass tops, which we'll go into. And so these are some things to be mindful of. And then you have your helper roles. This is often assisting people in ways that affirm their identities. This can be your religious institution sometimes, sharing skills, connecting people to decision-making tables, providing kind of education, et cetera. So now we'll just go into kind of like, let's see how we're doing on time too. Okay, we're doing good on time. So we'll kind of go into a story, and I have this picture up right here, just listing the roles, but the words under it are not necessarily mine. This is something I got from Virginia Progressive Leadership Project. So we're gonna tell you a different story, but it doesn't involve those specific organizations unless it's just a coincidence. But I'll let you start off and I'll delve in, and we can kind of hone in on, I guess, over the summers where you and I have most commonalities.
Yeah, well, that just seemed the most recent and relevant, probably most fresh on people's minds. I think summer 2020 was a call to action for almost everybody. You know, we were cooped up, it was peak pandemic, and we had no choice but to, everyone had no choice but to truly pay attention to what was happening in the world around us, and the disenfranchisement or oppression that people were experiencing as a result of a global pandemic. It really shined a spotlight on all of the things that weren't equitable and the way that people were being disenfranchised. So people had really started to pay notice. And so we saw a lot of movement work emerge, and we saw a lot of people come out and not really know what to do and which way to advocate, which way to support. So there's, I wanted to share some examples of how I participated in the summer. I have a history of advocacy and activism prior to the summer, especially just because of my roots in social work and a lot of comrades that I have as a result of that. But just reflecting on this past summer, or summer 2020 specifically, there are examples of individual movement work that I engaged in. So some of that did become community work, but one of those was creating a list of businesses that were impacted by the downtown uprising. So that was those early days of the protests after George Floyd was murdered by police. What we did was put together a Google Doc, listed every business that was impacted downtown, mostly Broad Street and the Jackson Ward areas. And if you are from Richmond or Central Virginia, Jackson Ward was really the Harlem of the South. And so realizing that there was also a history that goes into goes into that community. And so what we did was we created a list, or what I did was create a list of how to support and patronize all of the businesses that were impacted. We collected every GoFundMe and we put them together. And it started as just a few people, and then it was circulated amongst a lot of people. And so a lot of people were able to get their GoFundMes met, got their windows fixed. A lot of businesses saying, we support the movement, but we've been hurt. And so how can we get some support from the community? And so that's one example of some movement work. And yeah, we can definitely analyze the roles that took up and what came up there.
And I'll just chime in, because part of this is just recognizing you know, all of the people in the movement. So I was working with, well, just started like a new position with BLM, Black Lives Matter 804. Similarly, Kristen, we were fundraising. We did a GoFundMe campaign, a day off for solidarity, one to provide, recognizing not all people can afford to take the day off. Not all people have paid time off. So providing stipends to help advocates that do want to, activists that do want to engage in demonstrations, giving them access to that. We also did a rebuild our VA campaign to prioritize investing in the Black businesses, some of which were damaged because of the demonstrations. And see, Lisa, I see love song. And then we were also partnering with the Urban League and just wanting to more organizers to kind of work together. So we served as the hub of an organizing group where we could leverage supports, co-plan together for demonstrations, help each other market, et cetera. We also did a lot of volunteer recruitment, because if you've ever planned a march or a demonstration, it requires communications components. It requires the safety, ensuring your demonstrators are safe when it comes to car marshals, floaters, bike marshals, et cetera, making sure people don't get hit by cars. And so that was another form of engagement that we were able to provide a support role to other organizations and organizers and activists.
So really analyzing these approaches and recognizing the roles that come up. So roles of organizer, roles of rebel by engaging in non-traditional protest movements. And I always like to take a pause when we talk about protesting specifically and how we disrupt the concepts of like the peaceful protester, because protesting is not a moment of peace. We are in a moment of agitation. But what's really started to drive some narratives over the summer, and this speaks a little bit more to some of the effectiveness or ineffectiveness that's perceived in like rebel activism, is people painting the picture of like, oh, you're peaceful protesters, nonviolent protesters. Those are like quote unquote the good protesters. The people that do the sit-ins, that aren't destroying property. And the message that's relaying is that physical property and businesses, windows are more important than radical movement or challenging the status quo or and it's putting property over people. And a lot of that commentary was coming up over the summer. And so processing that, holding that, and recognizing the damage that a peaceful protester narrative can put on social justice movements in general, especially if they do street activism.
Mm-hmm. So ditto that. So over the summer, you know, we could look at the rebel world. Those people who made the news were applying pressure, were speaking out against Mayor Stoney, for example, and the governor because of their my brain is it was the curfew. There's the word. Curfew.
Yep, that's right.
Mm-hmm. Et cetera. And then there were the helpers. There are more religious organizations providing food, snacks to demonstrators, et cetera. Yeah. There were the advocates, you know, organizations that have 501c3 statuses or that have formal organizations that were kind of engaging in the special session that, for example, followed the demonstrations. And then there were clear activists and organizers in the movement. So, you know, really the question this poses is, what role do we think was more effective? What role do we think was less effective? Do you all feel one role was more effective than the other?
I think they all play a part. I wouldn't want to see rebels go away for the sake of so-called peacefulness. So I know.
Exactly, Lisa. Thank you. And that's truly the point that we're driving home. It takes a lot of roles to support these moments. So, you know, are there helpers that are helping to nourish and help take care of advocates and activists? You know, there was opportunities for pro bono, for therapists to offer pro bono services, especially after, you know, over down here in Richmond, there was that curfew that Chloe mentioned earlier. And then there was a tear gassing like 15 minutes before the curfew was supposed to be enacted. And it resulted in a lot of activists and advocates, people at that protest, experiencing police brutality, including families, because they were out there before the curfew was supposed to start. It was like 7:50. And so realizing that there was healing that needed to be done to support people that were experiencing post-traumatic stress as a result of activism and street activism, especially that summer.
Mm-hmm. So it's a perfect segue. Just recognizing, you know, there are different people playing different roles that even supersedes the four that we posed to you today. And so those are your weavers, people promoting connectivity. Those are your healers. Those are your visionaries, people stepping into leadership roles, et cetera. And those are your storytellers. So there's numerous ways. And I think people often feel like it has to be the activist or it has to be the advocate talking to policymakers at the General Assembly, but there's other roles too.
Definitely. Yeah. And I was just going to add that feeding and nourishing these folks is such a big part of how people were able to support, you know, just being able to hop online and say, hey, if people could just Venmo some money this way, what we're going to do is we're going to buy some pizzas for all these folks, or we're going to get some waters for these folks, or protest supplies to protect from things, from elements or otherwise. There's so many ways that people could participate, even just from home. It didn't have to be, I know a lot of rhetoric and some chants are even, out of your house, into the streets. But there's plenty you can do in your house if we want it to be an equitable movement and a movement that invites people that can access from different ways.
Yeah.
Lisa, I saw you come off mute.
Oh, I was just thinking when you said food, and I was thinking sustenance and about, you know, the bus boycotts and how people were able to stay on that boycott for so long. It's because lunches were being made and people were, it was like a whole community doing their part and playing their roles.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And so what the research shows, I've been engaged in a lot of research recently around just frameworks for social, racial equity and social justice, is that oftentimes these movements do start at the grassroots level, and that's where they do provide momentum, and that's when they are accepted. But to be successful continuously, they typically do move into some sort of organizational strategy, and that's when they risk either maintaining their support or losing their support in the movement. So that's typically how social movements play out long-term from a maintenance perspective. I'm gonna quickly just go into some other, seeing these strategies play out in different roles. So for Black Lives Matter 804, we've done a lot of advocacy around a civilian review board. We've decided to pause that advocacy and go into more targeting the elections, because in Henrico specifically, we have a board of supervisors with 3 Republicans and 2 Democrats. So that threatens, you know, our ability for if we do get a civilian review board, which they say we can have, but it won't be effective because they won't give it any power. But nevertheless, you see us in activism strategy on the left, us, you know, reinvigorating some momentum around civilian review boards after Supervisor Nelson threw in the towel and gave up. So you do see us engaging in some activist strategies, but also advocate strategies.
My name is Chloe Edwards, and I serve as the president of Black Lives Matter 804 and a resident of the Brooklyn District. Speak as the granddaughter of a Black police officer, Robert Edwards. At the age of 15, I ran away from home to escape abuse. After calling the police to seek help, I was told by a white male police officer that he used to be a rebellious child like me, and what he learned to do was be quiet. As a result, I was forced to face more years of abuse before finally getting the help I had desperately asked for and needed. As a teenager, I was placed in kinship foster care with my grandfather and grandmother. Over the summer and during the pandemic, my grandfather, a man of already a few words, struggled to speak while in hospice care. However, upon learning that I was engaging in work with Black Lives Matter, he managed to give a simple thumbs up. While my grandfather served as a police officer, he was a Black man first, before a police officer, and he too had experienced police brutality even while working in the sector. This year alone, we seek justice for Micaiah Bryant, Matthew Williams, Dante Wright, James Johnson, Dominique Williams, Marvin Scott III, Genoa Donald, Patrick Warren, Xavier Hill, Robert Howard, and Vincent Belmont. Yet, this issue also impacts children. A study by the Journal of the American Academy of Pediatrics reported that Black children were 6 times more likely and Latino children were 3 times more likely to be shot than their white peers. In addition, from 2003 to 2018, 140 adolescents died from police intervention. Researchers at Indiana University studied over 80 civilian review boards across the nation and found boards reduced racial disparities in certain stops and arrests. However, boards with investigational authority were the only ones that led to a reduction in police homicides of community members. As a result, we wish to clarify that we are asking for an effective civilian review board with authentic people power, as this is a fundamental value of democracy and, in fact, what has placed each of you in your positions of power to represent we the people that stand here today. Please adopt the following priorities: the power to monitor and audit police, the power to independently investigate incidents and complaints, the power to discipline officers in serious cases, transparency in findings and in operations. The best oversight model is one that meets the needs of the community and requires the formal powers to implement the civilian review board's day-to-day work. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, I mean, it's pretty much example of advocacy and activism. You see on the left, the more grassroots, but on the right, it's more grass tops. I'm targeting the Board of Supervisors. I'm not necessarily bringing the same energy that I'm going to bring from the streets. But you'll see that my language when I'm engaging in activism, it's tactful, but it's a little more aggressive than the kind of language I'm going to use in this testimony, for example. So this was advocating for HJ House Joint Resolution 537 to declare racism as a public health crisis, which made Virginia the first state in the South. And this is me providing testimony at one of the, I believe it was the Rules Committee.
Hello, good morning. My name is Chloe Edwards with Voices. Over 55 organizations and 285 individuals across the state expressed support of this specific resolution. Despite the progress for civil rights, being a person of color in this country can have a negative health consequence and even a death sentence, as we witnessed during this pandemic. 5 states and over 150 local governments have made declarations to explicitly address racism. However, none in the South. Virginia has the opportunity to lead the country into a new era in which everyone has access to this nation's fundamental values of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Solidarity occurs when the entire community stands alongside those who experience injustice. For this purpose, we stand together with hopes that it will be the pleasure of the committee to vote in support of this resolution. Thank you.
Thank you.
So that resolution ended up being successful. Virginia was made the first state in the South to declare racism as a public health crisis. But again, a different strategy, but was still effective in this circumstance. So I'll pass the mic back to you, Kristen.
Yeah, sure thing. So just like Chloe started to mention already, but we'll just define it a little bit more for you concretely here, is the strategies of grass tops and grassroots advocacy. So grass tops advocacy, like the first, like those examples, involves enlisting the help of individuals who have personal connections with the decision makers that are being targeted. So political donors, current and former leaders of the decision makers, political party, or other influential people are ways that grass tops advocacy is done. And then grassroots advocacy, I think that that's actually the wrong text for that. That's grass tops again. That's okay. But grassroots though is like organizing and mobilizing, engaging the public so they can advocate for themselves. So self-advocacy, things like attending this training so that you understand historical cultural context to inform your own advocacy, whether it be with other orgs and advocating for yourselves.
Yeah, and I'd say grassroots is more about, you know, centering the power of the people and the voices of the people rather than centering the power of the politician. So that's really the key between grassroots and grass tops advocacy. Grassroots is very much at the grassroots level, and the success or the effectiveness isn't going to be necessarily centered or the initial target. The politician's voice is not the priority. And if anything, they're applying pressure to get to be listened to and to be heard. So that's really the key difference.
Mm-hmm. Kind of like Lisa, you shouted out Song earlier. So Southerners on New Ground, we don't engage in political activism, but we do like trainings together to build our skills as facilitators or de-escalators in the community, building our own skills so we can support and provide and mutual aid and things like that versus engaging in a political realm.
Right, and that's why we see a lot of mutual aid, bail funds, et cetera, in the activist space. So I'm going to just keep going because I have another break that's in two slides and then we'll be wrapping up. So we're gonna quickly brush on resistance. So I encourage you all to, there's the thinker, the minimizer, the fairness seeker, the autonomy status seeker, and the certainty seeker. So in order to really, you know, be able to identify resistance, we have to acknowledge when it's happening. So I encourage you to think of the words and the topics that cause individuals to feel defensive or make them want to continuously protect the status quo. In simplest terms, resistance is known as the disruption of existing power or structures and privilege. And so resistance combats oftentimes the hierarchical nature of systems and status. It causes individuals to become upset because we're challenging the notion of the tradition of what they're used to, recountering narratives, et cetera, some of which people have been taught their entire lives. So organizations and leaders can develop a habit of kind of mapping out when resistance happens. Let's see, the thinker often takes on a variety of forms. This is the person who's often playing like the devil's advocate or the person always, you know, requesting data. And so we say when encountering the thinker, we might come up with data points or citations to prepare for them. But note that, you know, we're not going to go out of our way to provide all X, Y, and Z data points. Like, we have to recognize when people are just not going to be convinced and invite them to do their own research as well. And then there is often the minimizer, the person who's like, can't we all just get along, or I don't see color, and or the real world isn't fair. Approaches to the minimizer can be using strategies such as storytelling, case studies, providing testimony or visibles or videos, small group discussions, modeling to them in which fairness does not equate to justice modeling for them when, you know, strategies like I don't see color are not fair. And so that brings me to the fairness seeker. And so this person's often doesn't really understand the difference between equity and inequality. They believe like fair means equal, equal everything, equal in redistributions, or this may be someone who a white person who did grow up poor. And so this is mapping out examples for them of when equal is not fair. showing explicit examples between equity and equality. There's the thinker who takes on, we did the thinker. So I think I'm doing the autonomy and status seeker now. So the autonomy and status seeker often, when presented, they often want voice and choice in decision-making roles. They don't quite understand their role in equity and justice. And so, or they want, you know, a bit more of autonomy, a bit more of control. And so this is the person that you might invite to come onto a leadership team to give them a more autonomy and a leadership role in order to create better buy-in. And then lastly, there's the, I think I didn't do the certainty seeker. So this is the person that wants to specifically see their role and how they will contribute to justice. So perhaps providing like a step-by-step implementation plan for them, technical assistance, or providing a point person to support them can really empower them to engage more in the work. So there are these principles that you all can follow there. I'm not gonna go through them all, but I'll provide it with the slides. These are just racial equity principles that can put more tools in your toolkits in how you face resistance. But ultimately, I'm not encouraging you all to do backflips and jumping jacks in circles around people who just don't wanna do this work in an authentic way. So if anything, when we see that, sometimes the best strategy is disengagement, but these are some principles that you can follow if you are facing more forms of resistance. And so I'm just gonna keep going and then we'll do our calm at the end. We have two upcoming opportunities, the storytelling workshop as well as the rally towards the future Living Dr. King's Dream on January 7th and then January 17th. You can also always join our Racial Truth Coalition as well. And then we have our rally, like that's more information on the rally towards the future and the link that you all can visit. For policy specific topics, you can always reach out to myself. I cover public health, trauma informed care, equity and social justice, as well as my colleagues who cover other issues. And then Kristen is always a resource as it relates to the coalition and advocacy and engagement opportunities.
I'm just dropping links in there for the Racial Truth Coalition and committees. If you wanna learn more, that's that first link. And then I'll add the link now to the rally in January as well.
Thank you. Now I'm winding down, I just wanna go over the word Sankofa. It's an African word, which means, and you see this bird looking back, and it means go back and get it. And that's the meaning of Sankofa. It comes from Ghana. It's an Akan term and literally means go back and get it. And so one of the symbol depicts a mythical bird flying forward with its head turned backward. And it is not a taboo. It's to fetch what is at risk of being left behind. And it encourages us to, you know, we recognize we can use it in a metaphorical way that it took us 400 years to get here. And it's because we didn't go back and get what was left behind. And so that's what we're doing now. But I'll end with another African proverb, which means ashe, which it means the power to make things happen or so let it be. So ashe, the power thing to make things happen and so let it be. And we'll end with just a small breathing bubble to remind us to recuperate and to be mindful of where we are in ourselves. And so I'll play that quickly and then we will end. All right. Well, thank you. Thank you everyone for joining us today. I'll end with this contact information slide as you're moving out. And we just thank you for your time today. Again, Ashe, the power to make things happen. And so let it be.
I've been sleepless at night, 'cause I don't know how I feel. I've been waiting on you just to say something real. There's a light on the road and I think you know. Morning is coming.